church will be held today in the sanctuary at 9:30 in the morning. Purposes of meeting include following: approval of the 2018 terms of call for pastors, review of the 2017 annual reports, presentation of the 2018 budget as approved by session, nomination and election of the parish members for the 2018 Congregation Nominating Committee, and consideration of any other business pertinent to the life of the congregation.
Hey, thanks, John. We'll have that meeting right after this service. And so as soon as we're done with the benediction, we'll kind of take a minute to reset, and then we will start the meeting. We really invite every active member to be a part of it, and we have to have a quorum in order to do it, and if we don't, then we'll just do it next week. But please stick around, we'll have the annual meeting, and we will have other copies of the annual report if you didn't bring yours or get one. So please be a part of that today. And then, I'd like to invite Michelle Clark to come forward and make an announcement about an upcoming event.
So that's Ruby's house, and then Ruby and her two daughters are on the bottom. So the missions team is continuing their partnership with Habitat because we believe this is an amazing way for us to be the hands and feet of Christ in our community. So we decided to have another trivia fundraiser, but we need your help. We currently have 7 teams registered, and we're hoping to get 18 like we had last year. You do not need to have a full team. You don't have to be a member of the church, and you can be young or old. So, if you don't have, maybe there's just 2 or 3 of you, I'm happy to get together for you. Let's see. Oh, we're also looking for donations for our trivia or auction baskets. So anything that you think would go into one of those baskets, whether it's 1 item or more, we are happy to take it. And then all the proceeds for this fundraiser will go to help build a house for Herman Fernandez, who was the other family. She's on the top. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. We're so glad that you're here. Let's worship God together.
Thank you. means forever.
He has established his throne forever.
He will judge the world in righteousness.
He will govern the people with justice.
He is a refuge for the oppressed.
He is a stronghold in times of trouble.
Those who know you, your name, will trust in you.
For you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you.
Let us worship God. All God's children say.
Amen.
But this we call in mind, and therefore we have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never, ever ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. In the name of the Lord, who is our hope, I declare to you that our sins are forgiven. May our mouths be filled with praise every day.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And what's your name again? I'm
sorry. Jim.
Jim, Brett.
Yeah,
okay.
Brett.
And your name?
Jan.
Jim.
Good morning.
Jesus, right? They're always trying to get him to say something that they can maybe like get rid of it, throw him in jail, do something. But Nicodemus was one of these Pharisees, but he was a prophet. He seemed to have an open mind a little bit, I think, because he went to Jesus. He had a lot of questions. He went to Jesus. Jesus was out preaching and healing, there were crowds and crowds of people on. Not the only reason. Think about it. He's a Pharisee. Bad guy. Right? Does he really want these other bad guy friends to see him having a little conversation with Jesus? No. It would be bad for him. His boss won't fire him. He won't have any friends after that. They were not happy with him. Sinners, Pharisees. They're better than that, right? So he snuck at night, found Jesus, and had this long conversation. Part of the conversation is about light and dark. So look at the slide I put up for today. There's light and dark in there, right? How many of you have been in the woods before? And there's parts of the woods where the trees are really, really thick, and you can't see, right? And then there are other parts that open up like that, and then they can see the sunshine, right? So there's light and dark in the world. There's light and dark in our lives. There was light and dark for Nicodemus. Their light part of Nicodemus was that he really wanted to know who Jesus was and what he was doing. Jesus was the light part, right? So that's a question. Jesus is our light. God sent Jesus to us to be
when things are dark and lonely, and where there might be sadness, where there might be mistakes, where there might be things that we need to improve on, right? Okay, so Jesus says, "I lie." Lord, thank you for
Well, you've had a preview. Our scripture reading today, actually, I would hate to say this is a familiar story, but it's a story that we hear in church circles fairly frequently, the story of Jesus and Nicodemus. And what's interesting is that sometimes we kind of gloss over some of the details, so we just focus on the fact that that Jesus has some good things to say to Nicodemus. The truth is, like Erlynn said to the kids this morning, Nicodemus came at night in the darkness, under the cover of secrecy, kind of wondering, get some answers to some questions. And that's where we're turning today, as we turn to the third chapter of John. So let's first begin with the word of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word, all that it means for us, for the way you guide us in amazing ways. Lord, we thank you for opening up your word, and thank you for giving us hope. And thank you for telling us how to follow you more faithfully each and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now I'm going to read from John chapter 3. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God. For no one could perform the miraculous signs that you are doing if God were not with you." In reply, Jesus declared, "I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." "How can a person be born again when they are old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You are Israel's teacher," said Jesus. "And do you not understand these things? I tell you the truth. We speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen. But still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How will you then believe if I speak to you of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, as he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done through God." This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for your holy word. We thank you for the loving share and the way that you simply guide us in our lives, Lord. What an amazing thing that you take the time to tell us what we need to know in order to be your true and perfect servants. Lord God, help us today to think about what it means to be your followers, to try to follow and help them. In Jesus' name we pray. So it's one Sunday morning. I can't see. That's okay. But I can't see. I can't see Larry. And it's important that I see Larry. So one Sunday morning, a little boy was late for his soccer game, because they have those on Sunday mornings. And anyway, he was late for the soccer game, and his coach said, "Why are you late?" And he said, well, had to decide whether to go to church or whether to come to the game. And I decided I would flip a coin to decide which one I would do. And the coach said, well, that doesn't explain why you're late. How come it took you so long? He said, I had to flip a coin 14 times. There are times when we know what the right thing is to do, and times when we kind of wonder, we're not quite sure, but always we're in this process of discerning. We're always trying to figure out, you know, how do I walk this path? You know, and here's the truth. The truth is, I don't think that there's anybody who calls themselves a follower of God who goes out intentionally and says, I don't think I'll follow God today. Sometimes we preach sermons and we kind of act like, you know, we'll just do right, we'll be okay. But the truth is, I think our problem is not deliberately trying to be abusive to our relationship with God. I think instead our problem is that sometimes when we walk outside the walls of the church, it's like we get this spiritual amnesia. It's just like we forget, because there's all this other stuff that we need to do out there. So it's not like we're intentionally trying to be, you know, away from God. It's just that the world out there sends us all these different messages. And that's been true for a lot of long time, even, I think, since time of inconvenience. But you look around at a church like ours, and you wonder, what constitutes life in a congregation? It's a good question. What constitutes life in this place? Is it lots of people in the seats? Do we just count how many people we have, and we reach a certain number, we know we have life? Or is it more than that? Perhaps it's how much money we spend on mission. And if we just spend up to a certain level, then maybe we're being really spiritual. Or maybe it's something else. Maybe it's the enthusiasm of our worship. And maybe if we just sing a little bit louder, God will hear us. And then we'll know we have life. Well, maybe it's something else. What constitutes life in ourselves? What constitutes life in yourself? Is it plenty of activities and things to do? Is it a sense of purpose in what you do? Is it work that you enjoy? Is it having people around you that you love? Or is it something else? In our lives, both within and outside of the church, kind of revolve around this search for fulfillment, just trying to find some sense of satisfaction, this sense of peace that comes with feeling like that kind of like what I'm doing. And we seem to ask it in a lot of different places. We ask it at work. We ask it in our families. We ask it if you're in school and your extracurricular activities. We find it in our busy schedules. And we even find it here in our congregations. We are among the busiest people in the world. We are. We have a lot going on. We live in a time and a place where we have access to more opportunities, to more options, to more resources than anyone else in all of history. And we have learned to make the most of our time, our technology, our talents, and our triumphs. In order to make that happen, we need life to have lots of things at our disposal. I mean, for crying out loud, a couple of weeks ago, my phone stopped working for just a little while. I thought my world had come to an end. I mean, I couldn't get phone calls, of course, but I couldn't access my email. I couldn't Google things that I wanted to Google. I mean, I was lost. I thought maybe the world had come to an end until I got it fixed. But we are like that. We are continually searching for ways to find that hope. Anybody ever watch Star Trek? Anybody ever watch Star Trek? I'm not like a Star Trek expert like others in my family, but if you think back, the very first Star Trek movie, and you don't have to have seen the movie to get this, the very first Star Trek movie was about the Enterprise. You've heard of the Enterprise, right? So the ship is going out because there's this huge, massive energy that's going to threaten the Earth. Something always has to threaten the Earth. And when they get there to this huge, massive energy, they find this surprise. And the surprise is that the center of this threat to the Earth is actually one of the very first Voyager space probes that NASA set out to explore. And it had come back to report what it had found. And its mission had been to go out into the world, or go out into the universe, and just collect all this data. Just find out whatever it could find out. And on the way, this is according to Star Trek, it encountered other planets and other societies and other kinds of creations. And basically what it had done is it came back and reported all that it had learned. And in the movie, and I thought this is so interesting, in the movie, this was the message from this probe that had learned everything that there was to learn in the universe. It came back and had one question. And the question was this: is this all there is? Is this all there is? An interesting question. I think sometimes we find ourselves in the same boat. No matter what we do, no matter how smart we are, no matter where we go, no matter what sort of things we accomplish in life, sometimes we wonder, is this all there is? Nicodemus, in our passage today, he was on that kind of search. You know, Nicodemus was a Pharisee, and no offense, Pharisees weren't necessarily bad guys, but Pharisees just didn't see things like Jesus did. And this Pharisee, of all the Pharisees, he knew that something was wrong with the way they were seeking out God. He was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He was a leader among his people. And he was no doubt respected and learned. And he is perplexed by what Jesus is saying because it doesn't fit with everything that they have been taught, with everything that they have practiced. They are supposed to be people of God, and yet it just doesn't match up with what they have learned. And so in spite of who he is, in spite of his standing among his people, comes to Jesus, and he's very uncomfortable. He comes to Jesus, and basically he says, tell me what it is you're trying to tell us. And he's not really trying to spar with him. He's not trying to trap him. He just wants to know, what is this all about? And what's really interesting, and they nailed it this morning up here, is that Nicodemus came to Jesus at night. It's not a surprise, and it's not a mistake. And it's not because he was too busy during the daytime to come see him. It's important because he didn't want to draw attention to himself. He didn't want to be seen. He wanted to kind of fly under the radar. He came in darkness so that he could try to find out if there was something else that Jesus had to say that he could grab a hold. And it's interesting, in the Gospel of John and elsewhere in the New Testament, we find that we use this whole concept of darkness and light to kind of represent either a spiritual understanding or a lack of understanding. Darkness is that place where we go, where we just don't quite connect with God, and light. No, light is where God shines his light upon us and gives us his hope. And Nicodemus is in the dark. He was a spiritual man, but he didn't quite know how to follow God. I read this passage the other day. I mean, that's us. That's me. If you ever find yourself in that dark place, if you ever find yourself in that darkness, it's an interesting, weird place. How about that in your life? When you're asleep at night, do you ever find yourself like in complete darkness? You wake up, your room's completely dark, and it's dark, and you can't see anything. But the truth is that you're never in complete darkness. Because if you lay there long enough, what happens? Your eyes start to adjust, don't they? And you start to see things that you didn't see before. And you start to realize that as your eyes adjust, you see more clearly and you see more and more things. I think that's the way it is in our spiritual lives. We often live like we are in this constant state of darkness. And we kind of see faint stuff every now and then, but we never really see the big picture. Until we allow Christ into our lives. To allow that light to come into our lives, and suddenly our eyes adjust and we can see that there is more for us than we ever imagined. No matter how long we've been in the church, it's still possible that we, well-intentioned as we are, just like Nicodemus, can find ourselves sometimes feeling like we are in this spiritual twilight. not really hiding from God, but just kind of, and not just completely in the dark, but just not ever really exposing ourselves to the light as much as we should. And oftentimes we stay there, and I don't know why, but it, sometimes maybe that's the comfortable place to be. No, we want to know enough about God, but we step into the light every now and then, but we don't want to be seen too clearly. And sometimes that dark, that shadowy place can be a little more comfortable, less exposed to the world, less prone to ridicule, fewer expectations, maybe. I don't know. The thing about dark is that we can hide there. We can hide there, maybe dabbling in faith just enough to make us feel good, but not so much that we have to really expose ourselves completely. Not anymore. Not if we pay attention to what we heard in this passage today. Because really what God's trying to do is God is trying to draw us out of the shadows, out of the darkness, out of our spiritual twilight, and simply come into the light and peace of the presence of God. Because that's where we find our fulfillment. And that's where we realize and experience the life that God has really caused. And that's where we know that we have the kind of satisfaction that only comes from being in sync with God. When we come into the light, we realize that it's very possible for us to walk out these doors without experiencing spiritual amnesia. And realize when we go out there, hey, it's okay to be people of Christ out there in the world where people are doing other things besides this. That light is a gift. Given this freely to us as it was to the kings. And it's a gift that we can put into our actions right now. We didn't read this passage today, but I really think it's interesting that if you look at the book of 1 John, which is later in the New Testament, you find this interesting message. This is the message we have heard from them and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him, yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. That's our goal, to walk in the light, to walk in the light of Jesus. Imagine what a difference it would make just for this congregation or for this community. We took that bold step to take that light with us wherever we went. I can imagine what a difference it would make in your life if that light was just with you all the time. Imagine what a difference it would make if we would allow that light to transform us in amazing ways. Sometimes I think we make it too hard. We think we have to learn certain things or have a certain amount of knowledge in order to really be people of God. And when we don't achieve that, or we feel inadequate, we think, well, what's the point of trying? That's not what it's about at all. We are not given a test. And we are not expected to have a certain level of knowledge, although all of that is good. What God really wants for us is simply to step into the light and be with you. That's it. A couple of weeks ago, I had a chance to go to Hessen House with our senior highs. I've got to tell you, what an amazing group of young people that is. What a great group of young adults. And they just stepped right in and helped. But I found this interesting, and it was my first time there. I've been to lots of places like that in lots of different communities. But it was a very cold night. And I noticed, the first thing I noticed was that, and they told me this, that there were no requirements put on the people who were lined up to come in to have a meal. There wasn't any requirement other than don't cause a disturbance. You know, everybody was expected to be peaceful and be nice to one another in there. That was the only requirement. Because the people that ran the place know and understand that what these people need as they line up on a cold night like that is a warm place to be and a warm meal to have in their stomachs. That's the basic thing that they knew. And they were invited into that place that night. And they received both those things. And I'm sure in the back of the minds of the people who run that great mission and ministry, is that once those people experience the warmth of the building and the warmth of the meal and the warmth of the hospitality inside, then they're more open to other opportunities that they have to share with them in terms of the rest of their lives. And it struck me that that is exactly what God wants from his church. You see, God sees us lined up, and God realizes that we are hungry for something. And God puts no requirement on us. He simply tells us, come in where it's warm. Come in where I can feed you. Come in and be with me. And that's what we're all about, friends. When we line up here and decide to come into this sanctuary, it's not about worrying whether or not we're worthy. But it's simply coming inside where God has something very special to feed us. That's what Nicodemus was looking for that night. He was looking for the kind of spiritual food that he had gotten from nowhere else, in spite of the fact that he was a very learned and scholarly man. And he got something from Jesus that he didn't ever expect. But the question is, what happens? What happens? We put ourselves in Nicodemus' shoes. What questions would you ask? What answers do you need? What would you seek as you step into Christ's presence? What would you need in order to take the next step in whatever your life of faith is? Guess what? The answers are here. They are right in front of us. God gives it to us freely. And that message is available. That spiritual food is there for everyone who simply steps forward and says, I am here. Is this all there is? Not for us. Not for us. For those of us who believe in and follow Jesus Christ, there is so much more. And it is available to all of everyone who asks. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word and the love that you share. And we pray, O Lord, that each one of us will step into your presence and experience your life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Teach us to walk as faithful stewards. We pray for the dying and for those who have died. May they rest in your eternal glory. Lord God, we pray for the specific joys and concerns of this gathered community. We pray for a sister-in-law, Jeannie, with stage 3 cancer starting chemo on Tuesday. We continue to pray for Mary Heath, for Ben and Ethan Grace, for Derek and Anita, for Tom, for Kenny, for Tom and Victor, for young Braden. We continue to pray that all of those on this earth can be their true selves, that they will be accepted for who they are, who you made them to be. God of grace, we give thanks for your faithfulness to us, for your endless grace offered us in your Son. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, transform us in love, grow us in faith, call us to love with a full heart, and to share your promises with all people through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God longs for us to bring everything that we are, everything that we have, to this relationship. God loves us that much. May the offering we bring this day be tokens of a reciprocal desire.
Thank you. Thank you.
lamp that I wear like when I do things outside when it's dark, or snow blowing in the dark, or checking the chickens, or going fishing. And I was really proud of my headlamp, you can picture this, until I met John Hyatt, who has the headlamp of all headlamps. Compared, his headlamp is a headlight, and my headlamp turns out to be like a little pen light. I think that's the way it is when we discover the light Christ has to give to us. We think we know the light, but what we really know is just a little piece of the light. But the more we step into the light, the more we realize that God has more and more to share with us. And the more we step into it, the more God illumines our lives and illumines our faith and lights the path that he wants for us to follow. And today, that's our charge for all of us, to follow the light where we go. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you.
Have a good week. Thank you.